Welcome back. You're still watching Insight. Soaring food costs are weighing on consumers, with last month's food inflation coming in at 9.7%. This is driven by faster inflation of prices of rice, vegetables, and fruits. Let's zero in on the culprit of this unprecedented rise in food prices. We're joined by former Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Ernesto Pernia. So the Philippine government imposed a price cap on rice to arrest the soaring prices of the commodity. Do you think that was effective? I mean, could we have seen an even higher inflation if the price cap was not imposed?
No, I think it was a wrong decision on the part of the president. In fact, the economic managers were not in favor of that action, but they had to accommodate what he had done.
I mean, what do you think caused the significant increase in rice prices? I mean, a lot of people and even the government was blaming the high prices of imported rice. And I think partly it was due to India deciding to ban exports. But do you think there was a domestic factor involved for the significant increase in rice prices?
Our rice supply, given our rice productivity, limited rice productivity, was also constrained. It was not enough, and we have a huge population consuming rice. So that that accounts for why the rice prices went up. And even with importation, if it is not timely, or if there are problems with hoarding, and all kinds of activities that prevent the sale of rice in the market, then you have this problem.
Right now, for example, the price of rice is going down due to harvest and the arrival of imports. Do you expect the drop to be sustainable, or most likely it will go up again, or this will be a recurring problem for us?
After the rice harvest, there will be a problem if imports are going to be brought to the Philippines again, and there's always a higher price for imports compared with what we can produce domestically.
So another factor driving food costs higher is the rising price of fuel. So with the conflict in the Middle East escalating, and pushing up the prices of oil, what can the Philippine government do to mitigate the effects?
From the beginning, we should have improved our rice production. We have this agrarian reform, and agrarian reform has made the plots of farm rather limited, about 5 hectares. That has been a problem in terms of greater volumes of rice production and supply in the market. In fact, many of the owners of small rice farms have also sold the farm sizes that they have.
The land, yeah.
That's right, the land, yeah, right.
Do you have any suggestions on how to boost the local agriculture sector? Because that seems to be the problem, or the solution to the problem that we're currently having.
In terms of agriculture, we seem to have skipped the process of really generating our agricultural sector, making sure that it will be sufficient and the productivity will be high, and the supply from rice and other agricultural products will be sufficient. But even before really making our agriculture sector efficient, we shifted to manufacturing. And even from manufacturing, we also shifted. We jumped to services, and that is why we have a problem with our different sectors of our economy in terms of agriculture, manufacturing, and service sector. Our service sector is the biggest sector. I think it's about 60%, and agriculture is supposed to be 10% at least. But I think it's only 2%. of agriculture that is producing, you know, agricultural products. So, and then manufacturing is also around, 20%. These sectors of the economy are really have not really matured compared with our ASEAN neighbors like Vietnam and Thailand and Malaysia. And also, given we have the largest population in ASEAN vis-a-vis a land area. Of course, Indonesia has a bigger population, but they have a huge land area. But we have a limited land area too. This has been the main sources of our problem. We did not develop agriculture to maturity enough. Our manufacturing is limited compared with other ASEAN countries.
So at this point, what can the government do to boost agriculture? You said that we kind of skip developing it, but what can we do now?
It cannot be developed overnight, of course. So we should have, the president should have from the very beginning already exerted adequate effort to develop agriculture, because he decided to be the Secretary of Agriculture, but I don't think he has done anything really that would improve the agricultural sector.
What about appointing a full-time agriculture secretary? Would that help? And what could the secretary bring to the table?
That should have been done from the beginning. Get somebody who really knows agriculture and who can you can develop agriculture to the fullest extent.
What are some quick wins for the agriculture sector that would, at least help?
Rice is something that can be done quickly. I mean, if you have enough irrigation and other sources of making the agriculture sector more productive, that will improve not only agriculture. Sugar is also something that can be done better instead of being limited to certain regions only. It's really something that could have been done, but we didn't do it. And so what can be done now? It's not something that can be done quickly. So that's why we have to import in the meantime to fill in the supply gap.
So with that, thank you very much for your thoughts, Dr. Pernia, on the agriculture sector and on inflation. And I do hope that, the Philippines will be able to address these problems in the near term. Thank you so much. After several years, the Philippine Stock Exchange is finally scheduled to launch its short selling program on October 23. Short selling is defined by the PSE as the sale of a security that will be settled by the delivery of borrowed securities. The Stock Exchange is hopeful that this new product will help boost market activity in the local bourse, which is lagging behind those of other regional markets. At present, investors in the local market can only profit from rising prices, as they can only buy securities when they expect prices to go up. With short selling, investors can also profit from an expected decline in prices, as they can sell borrowed securities at a higher price and to buy the same securities at a lower price in the future. However, it might take a while for short selling to gain popularity in the country. Not all securities can be shorted. At present, only stocks that belong to the PSEI Index, Mid-Cap Index, Dividend Yield Index, and exchange-traded funds can be shorted. The timing of its launch is also not so good, as Philippine stocks are currently trading at very cheap valuations. Note that the PSEI Index is trading significantly below its historical average PE multiple. Because of this, potential gains from shorting local stocks might not be lucrative to most investors. Moreover, it costs more to short stocks than to go long, This as investors with short stocks also need to pay interest on the borrowed shares and reimburse the amount of dividends that accrue on loaned shares on top of transaction costs. Investors also need to provide and maintain enough collateral before they can borrow shares. The amount of collateral is quite significant at no less than 105% of the value of the borrowed securities. Shorting stocks is also riskier compared to buying stocks. While the potential loss of investors who go long is limited to the amount of capital they use to buy stocks, the potential loss of investors who go short is unlimited because the price of stocks they sold can more than double in price. Because of the higher cost and greater risk, short selling is not for everyone. In fact, it won't be surprising if stockbrokers only provide short selling services to more experienced and professional investors. It will be interesting to see the success and evolution of short selling in the Philippines over time. Despite numerous growth pains, the development of new products such as short selling is necessary to fuel the long-term growth of the local capital market. Before we wrap up the show, we leave you with a quote from economist and diplomat John Kenneth Galbraith. Nothing so weakens a government as inflation. And that's it for this week's edition of Insight. I'm April Litan. Thank you for watching.